President Trump revealed he tested positive for coronavirus on Friday. By the next day, he was receiving care at Walter Reed Medical Center. So the White House said the president was making the move out of abundance of caution. But as epidemiologist Dr. Abdul El-Sayed notes, taking the president to the hospital in the middle of his reelection campaign is a serious development and more likely due to the president's need of hospital-level treatment.
So Crooked Media's America Dissected also took aim at Trump's SCOTUS nominee, saying that if Judge Amy Coney Barrett is confirmed and the Supreme Court strikes down the Affordable Care Act, millions of Americans will not be able to receive proper care without massive hospital bills. CNN commentator, author, and public health doctor Dr. Abdul El-Sayed joins us now to talk about all of these things. Great to see you.
Good to see you, Doc.
Thank you for having me. Mm-hmm.
Can you just take us through what we know about the president's current condition, the drugs that he's been taking, and what you can glean from the information that is available to all?
Well, I will say it's hard because what's been clear is that the White House has not been at all transparent about his condition. What we do know, though, is that he is on a cocktail of medications that frankly, is unprecedented. He's on remdesivir, which is an antiviral, dexamethasone, which is a steroid treatment designed to knock back your immune system from having too serious a reaction that might make you even sicker than the viral infection might in the first place. And then he's receiving a cocktail of monoclonal antibodies from Regeneron, which is still in phase three, meaning you really can't get it unless your doctors, you know, want to throw a Hail Mary. And the crazy thing is that we don't know of any circumstances where all three of these medications have been used at the same time. We know that there are circumstances where the remdesivir and the dexamethasone are used at the same time, but all of them together, including the antibody cocktail, that's unprecedented. And it's hard to say whether or not he's on that treatment because his course has been so serious that they wanted to throw the kitchen sink at him, or it's because he's the president of the United States and they want to make sure that they're giving him everything, or it's because the president is possibly directing his own care. And this is not unprecedented. When you have these VIPs, oftentimes they'll demand the best care possible. And sometimes because of their relative power relative to their teams, they end up getting medications that that may not otherwise need if they didn't have that kind of power differential. And so it really is hard to say. They're saying that he may be discharged today. But what is clear is that he is getting the best government health insurance, health care that you can possibly have. And he seems to be liking it pretty well.
Okay, so doctor, I mean, you're an epidemiologist. That's why I'm glad we got to speak with you here. What would, I guess, a normal patient, what would it mean for them to get discharged by the hospital? Like, what criteria and conditions would a patient have to meet who has a moderate to severe case of coronavirus need to first be admitted to the hospital and then to get out of the hospital? Like, what are the criteria that you would look for?
Yeah, the circumstances to get admitted have everything to do with your ability to breathe on your own without the support of oxygen. And if a doctor thinks that you may need oxygen supplementation, then the high likelihood is that they'll admit you. And releasing you also has to do with that. We think that you're far enough out of the woods that you're not going to be back in a situation where you need supplemental oxygen, ranging from just a nasal cannula to something as serious as a ventilator. And in order for the team to make a decision about having hospitalized him in the first place, it's rather clear that he needed, or someone thought that he might need down the line, that oxygen therapy. And in fact, what seems to be coming out of the reporting right now, no thanks to the White House and their information, is that there seem to be two circumstances where he needed oxygen supplementation and in fact needed hospital care. And so we'll be watching to see what's happening. I know that he's doing everything and his team's doing everything to spin the story, going out on his joyride, putting his Secret Service members at risk, sealing them up in a sealed Secret Service van to go and wave to his supporters. Even despite that, it's pretty clear that he's probably not yet out of the woods, and we'll see the decisions that they make. It's really hard to disentangle the medicine from the politics here, and that's why it's really important for us to be able to look and say, was there a circumstance where he needed oxygen supplementation and received it? Because that really is the main criterion for acquiring hospital care.
Right. So we've gotten a lot of contradictory information. Certainly, Dr. Conley has been incredibly unhelpful and appears to have actually lied at times during his presentations. But we have been able to glean that he had a fever at some point, unclear how high that fever was, and that on two separate occasions, at least, his oxygen levels dropped below, I guess, 95%. talk about the significance of that and what that tells you about the seriousness of the case of coronavirus that he has.
Yeah, stepping back, the president is 74 years old. That itself puts him at high risk for a serious, potentially deadly COVID course. And on top of that, we know that he's clinically obese and he's been treated for heart disease risk factors in the past. Add that to the fact that, you know, now he's got a situation where his oxygen saturation has dipped. That really is concerning because the way that COVID-19 takes a life in most circumstances is by affecting the lungs, stopping the lung from being able to take in the oxygen, which, of course, is the main function of your lungs. And when that happens, your inability to maintain oxygen saturation, deliver oxygen to the rest of your body, in fact, can be deadly and also can have some long-term consequences. So the fact that that's happened twice suggests to us that, you know, he's had a relatively serious course. And in order, you know, for most people to be discharged in the context of having had their O2 sats drop like that, the doctors have to be relatively confident that it's not going to happen again. The question here is how confident they can be relative to the fact that he is the president of the United States. His hospitalization itself is a national security issue. And he's in the middle of a re-election campaign that he's losing pretty badly right now. The question is, does the politics trump the medicine or does the medicine get the last say? And unfortunately, with this president, the politics has always trumped the medicine, always trumped the science. And you wonder what the consequences may be for his own care, because we've seen what the consequences are for our country. 210,000 people who've died because for him, the politics always trumped the medicine.
This is another thing I'm actually curious with you, Doctor, which is that, in general, does what we're seeing with the way the president is being treated, what does that spell for future treatment of coronavirus? I mean, could it show that we do have some decent therapeutics, if we could make some of these things widely available, that they might work? Is there anything to be learned from this, is more what I'm asking.
Well, one patient really can't tell you that much. Mm-hmm. What we need to do is wait for the science and understand what the implications are. When we test these treatments in phase three, what we're asking is, number one, are these treatments safe? And number two, are they effective? And then there's a whole set of questions about how they may operate together. Now, we do know that across hospitals, doctors have been using dexamethasone and remdesivir together. But what we don't know is what the potential side effects may be of using them in confluence with this new Regeneron monoclonal antibody cocktail, because, of course, that hasn't cleared phase three on its own yet. One patient is really hard to glean much from. What we do know is there has been some strong science around these things, but we have to wait for the science to mature. You don't have to go back that far when the president was talking about how hydroxychloroquine was, you know, the be-all and end-all of treatments for COVID-19. But in phase three trial after phase three trial, the actual evidence from these clinical trials showed that the side effects of hydroxychloroquine more than outweighed the benefit that it may have offered. And so we've got to be patient with the science. We've got to be led by the science here. And we need multiple participant studies to really clarify what the best way to treat COVID-19 is.
Got it.
And finally, Doctor, if you had the opportunity to question the president's medical team today, what sorts of questions would you be raising with them?
Yeah, the real big question to me is, number one, when did his oxygen saturation drop? For how long and how far low did it get? What kind of oxygen supplementation did you put him on? And what was the response to that? I'd be asking about some of the side effects for some of the known treatments. I mean, we know that putting someone on a steroid, steroids are really serious drugs and they have a large side effect profile. So I'd be asking about how diligently they're watching for those side effects and if we've seen any of them. And then number three, I'd be asking how far are we from the last drop in his oxygen to know how far out of the woods he might be and how confident they are that it's not going to happen again. And then lastly, I'd be asking, you know, who made the decision to let this guy go out in a sealed SUV with Secret Service members so that he could wave to a bunch of folks on the side of a road? Because that just, you know, in any other patient, in any other circumstance, that would be a self-discharge against medical advice. And, you know, once that person got back to the hospital, they would be assessed and given a full psychiatric evaluation. Because what we do know is that one of the side effects of steroids is the steroid-induced psychosis. And so you've got to be asking, you know, is he doing this with a sound mind? Because we know that the side effect profile of these medications can include, misjudgments like this, because that is clearly an irresponsible and frankly reckless decision.
Yeah, well, I'm not a medical professional, but it seemed like pretty standard behavior from him from where I sit. Dr. Abdul El-Sayed, great to have you. Thank you so much.
Thanks, doctor.
Thank you for having me.
Next on Rising, new polls show Trump's numbers crashing after that first presidential debate with Joe Biden. We're going to talk about that when Rising continues.